Thank you, Pear. Thank you, KBOO. That KBOO has been so good to me and over this last decade, and I'm really happy to give KBOO a little helping hand here. We're trying to change the way money works, and you guys need KBOO. You guys are going to need KBOO a lot, and so it's important to keep these vital community institutions alive, and that's aside from Pear, who was also a community institution. But thank you, Pear. Let me ask, are there any Zeitgeisters here tonight? Anybody? Yeah? You can make a clap, okay, so I know you're there. Are there any CollapseNet members here tonight? Are there any Ron Paul supporters here tonight? Zeitgeist has film outlets in 70 countries. Their most recent film, Moving Forward, has been seen in 70 countries. They have outlets there. If you're a CollapseNet member, you know that opinion makers and movement leaders and decision makers in 66 countries are with us on CollapseNet. Anybody here from Transition US? Any transition initiatives tonight? Yeah, okay, that's all right. You don't have to be ashamed. This is a time to be proud. We kind of celebrate each other now. Transition movement is in 25, 30, I don't know how many countries now. I haven't been able to keep track. But we have a reach, and what we say here tonight is going to be widely viewed around the world. This speech tonight will be on CollapseNet for our members, and we encourage you to share it and get it out as much as possible. Anybody here tonight 30 years old or younger? All right, this speech is for you. And more than anything else tonight, I want anybody else who's here and listening to understand that the audience that I want to reach is those 30 and under, because you are a generation that has been thoroughly screwed. You are a generation that is being left with the wreckage, the ruin, the debt, the pollution, the collapse, the wreckage of human industrial civilization. And ever since I first was introduced to peak oil by a guy named Dale Allen Pfeiffer in 2001, right before I first spoke at Portland State, 10 years ago, we had 1,000 people turn up that night. It's been very clear to me that if I have a mission in life or a responsibility, and what we do at CollapseNet is all about serving the people who will be alive after this is over. So if you intend to be one of those, and most of you 30 and under are going to be there, this speech is really for you. And I'm going to say a lot tonight. I put myself in your shoes as I was framing some of the things that I was going to say tonight. This is going to be a different speech than I've ever given. I've given about 80 to 90 lectures in 8 countries. And I've never one had turn out the way this one did tonight. I was trying furiously to write all last week. And Max, my assistant, will tell you, I barely came out of my office all last week. And night before last, I was so overwhelmed. Events were happening so quickly, I couldn't assimilate them into the speech. And I found myself with 9,000 words of things I needed to say, which is way too much, having to throw up my hands and say, okay, I have to go to my heart and I have to go to spirit to decide how this is going to come together tonight, because I'm going to have to read you some of the stuff that I wrote, and there's other things that I have to talk about. So in a way, this will be, for those of you who understand that, this will be my heart song tonight. So here we are. And I want to start, I guess, by reading you something that went on CollapseNet a few days ago. We are the most useful an informative news and analysis site in the world right now. If you're a member, you know that we've been calling everything that has happened over the last 8-10 months to a year with absolute precision. So we have a map that works. But this is something that I put up, that I wrote a couple of nights ago for our members after the blackout in Southern California. You've all heard about that, right? Yeah, don't believe it was one lone workman, okay? The story was, single workman causes mass power outage affecting millions and shuts 2 nuclear reactors. Oops. We put this on our homepage, breaking news at collapsenet.com. And I wrote this comment. This should be a major concern. This is a quote from the story. The world public needs to, this is from Rice Farmer, the world public needs to wake up and see that nuclear reactors are ticking time bombs. If you've followed us on CollapseNet, you'll know that 2 days after Fukushima, CollapseNet was the first news entity in the world to recommend people start buying potassium iodide. And we absolutely and correctly predicted the series of events that would unfold if there was a containment breach. There have been three at Fukushima. And then I wrote, when overly complex civilizations fail, they fail spectacularly, colossally, and very quickly. They fail without consideration for anyone stuck on a thrill ride, waiting in an airport, or on life support. If nothing else, CollapseNet has done our members an invaluable service by educating, training, and preparing you for these times and these events. This is no surprise for us, but events like this should still be respected for the emotions they evoke. They rattle you. And those emotions should not be suppressed. At CollapseNet, we are emotionally, intellectually, and hopefully spiritually prepared, and we are not the slowest campers. Another new reality dawns, and the quickening continues. Why am I hearing Dick Marcinko screaming in my head, keep it simple, you stupid, deleted, deleted shithead? So many of us tried to warn and reach out for so long. But now is the moment when we can stop lamenting those we might have reached, and when we can truly start celebrating, finding, and loving the ones we did. Fukushima is a serious issue, and this is where I'm going to do the political stuff first, because after I'm done with the political stuff, I have to overturn the God of Abraham, and so I thought I would put that out. If he wants to strike me dead before I leave, he can put the paperwork through while I'm still talking. But the political stuff was harder than overthrowing God for me. But we have a serious issue. Now, we live in the Pacific Northwest, which stretches from British Columbia down to the San Francisco Bay. And I live in Sebastopol, about an hour north of the bay. And had you been a CollapseNet member, you would have known that neonatal mortality increased 35% in the 6 weeks after Fukushima in the Pacific Northwest. If you were a CollapseNet member, you would know that a catastrophic core breach melt through the floor of the containment vessel, I believe in one, has occurred, and apparently some groundwater has been reached, which is venting steam, radioactive steam, into the atmosphere. And as we've tracked this, I've relied heavily on a wonderful man, Arne Gunderson of Fair Winds. He is a nuclear engineer. God bless Arne Gunderson. And I've certainly taken stuff from Helen Caldicott and my own stuff. But last month on CollapseNet, we had a video from obviously an educated guy, a scientist in Toronto, and it had just rained very heavily in Toronto, and he was out with a Geiger counter wiping off his solar panels, and he put the paper towels underneath the Geiger counter, and he pegged the first scale. So he made a click, it's a logarithm, so the next scale was 10 times greater, it pegged that one. And he made it next time, which was 100 times greater, and it pegged that scale too. It was the highest recorded fallout reading ever in Toronto. You didn't hear about that in the news, did you? That's why you need to be on CollapseNet. And we asked where Arne Gunderson was, and Arne Gunderson came on with a tape a few days later. And trust me, people are being intimidated now. Censorship is rampant now, especially in the mainstream media. And Arne Gunderson released a tape after we publicly called for him to say something, and it came out and he said, a China syndrome may in fact be underway in Fukushima, meaning that the uncontrolled core, which they're undoubtedly pouring tens of millions of gallons of seawater on, or water on now to try and cool it, may reach a water table. And once it does, if it does reach, and it gets hot enough, it can separate the water molecules into the constituent elements of hydrogen and oxygen, which is an explosive mixture. That's what rocket fuel is made from, liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen, and trigger a Mount Krakatoa-like explosion, which would doom all six reactors at Fukushima, and all of that radiation would go up. Arne didn't rule that out, but what he said was there's something far more dangerous that people need to be worried about. And a CollapseNet, I'd like to honor and acknowledge Wesley Miller, who's our chief operating officer at CollapseNet. He's a former assistant DA here in Lake Oswego, so we have a lot in common. We were publishing the stories coming out of the Mainichi Times, the Japan Times. We scan the world for news 24/7. And Rice Farmer, who is our guy in Japan, helps collect the news stories that I process every day, lives in Japan. And he found the stories, and the Japanese have been incinerating cesium-tainted soil and cesium-tainted wreckage, and they've been sending the cesium directly into the atmosphere. And that's what caused the radiation readings to go off the scale in Toronto. It rained in Toronto. Now, ladies and gentlemen, our rainy season starts next month. Now, I called the Japanese government out, and many governments read CollapseNet. We have influence, because as soon as I started covering that, all coverage of incineration of cesium contaminated debris or products or anything else disappeared from the world media. Now, let me give you a clue. The seafood from the Gulf of Mexico is not safe to eat. FEMA is broke. The repairs for Hurricane Irene are, you know, there's no money. And now we know that the money to repair after Hurricane Irene is going to have to come when the Committee of 12 takes it out of social programs. Their first meeting is in 4 days. Did you know that the federal flood insurance program is insolvent? The government is broke. And in case you didn't know, our government has been lying to you about a great many things, like fix the economy. So we cannot trust the United States government to be our advocates or to tell us the truth. And we cannot trust the Japanese government to tell us truth about anything, because we know the Japanese government has been lying hand over fist. Tens of thousands of pounds of cesium-contaminated beef have been eaten by hundreds of thousands of Japanese. Japan is dying. It cannot be stopped, and Japan is a vital organ to the world economy. It's like the world economy losing a liver, the lungs. The world economy is dead, and that's how in April I was absolutely able to predict what was going to happen in the world economy starting the end of July and early August, right on the money. You see, you need to know what's coming on so you know what to be prepared for, but in the Pacific Northwest, we got a real problem. We cannot trust the U.S. government to approach the Japanese. We can't trust the Japanese to tell us what's going on. And we have to find some other way to communicate to Japan that it is not honorable for them to incinerate the radiation, insert it into the jet stream, and send it around the world. How do we do that? Well, there's a guy named Ron Paul. And if we have an election in 2012, he's the only person you should consider voting for, because his economic policies and what he wants to do, bring the troops home, kill the Fed, you know, and all of that. If you were to look at my book, Confronting Collapse, which is available for sale up there, and I'll be out there to put my paw print on them for you afterwards. This is all going to KABU, so if I'm making anything, that's off the book sales, and thank you very much. But what I said in there was, we have to liberate and empower states and localities. And what is Ron Paul all about? He's about reversing the flow of power from the localities and the states to the federal government. And that must be turned around, because relocalization and empowering local government is the only chance we have to survive the collapse of human industrial civilization. And I've said very clearly that it's very clear to me that the United States of America is doomed as a whole single nation. Things break down, not up. The United States of America was bound together by energy. The energy it took to mine iron ore, to melt it into steel rods, to forge the steel for locomotives, to chop the wood, the slave labor of the Chinese and all the people who laid the tracks. Our nation is bound together by the energy of the interstate highway system, which is paved in oil. And as the energy goes away, the bonds go away. And after Hurricane Katrina in 2005, at From the Wilderness, we were then read by 60 members of Congress. I said very clearly that this is the end of the American empire, because it was clear then, and my good friend Matthew Simmons, the late Matthew Simmons, made it very clear, he was the world's largest energy investment banker. He made it clear and he said, this is never all going to be fixed, and Katrina has never been fixed. And now we look at Irene, and of course there was a 6.4 off the coast in Vancouver the other night. We have the blackout. Do you understand what's going on? These events are getting closer together. So this nation cannot and will not hold together. And quite frankly, with the kind of service the federal government is performing for all of us, I wish them good riddance. But Ron Paul is extremely important, and what the reason why I started by talking about Zeitgeist and CollapseNet, Transition US, Ron Paul supporters, is we all find ourselves, millions of us, on one side of a line called infinite growth. And then all those other zombies find themselves on the other line, and it's a side of that line, and we need to start talking to each other, because we have vast common interests and we can do enormous amounts together. So if there is an election in 2012, it has to be Ron Paul, and I can firmly predict to you, and I got a pretty good record with this stuff, that that if he's not elected, there will be a revolution in this country anyway, and of course we may be on the brink of massive civil unrest anyway. But those are two political points that I really needed to make right up front, especially for the Pacific Northwest. And ham and eggs breakfast, the chicken's involved, but the pig is committed. And we're pigs when it comes to radiation from Fukushima. I got 2 acres in Sebastopol with like 45 edibles in the ground. We have 45, crops. And when our rains start in October, I don't want to be going out to my squash, to my pumpkins, to my corn, to my beans, to the berries, and with a Geiger counter to see if I can eat my food. So we have to find a way to communicate with Japan, to make our concerns known so that we can at least get disclosure. Now, public health officials, and you've got radiation detection to run by state and local in some places, but who is going to stand up and say to Japan, don't do this? I don't know. Necessity is the mother of invention. Now that I got that out of the way, let's go back to some of the stuff that I wrote, because I got to do some very important things tonight. I'm trying to be the red pill for you guys tonight. Few of us here today have any worries or concern extending backwards beyond even the financial collapse of 2008, just 3 years ago. If you do, you're missing something. Are you still hoping that your 2005 mortgage that's upside down will somehow turn right side up again? Are you hoping that you'll be able to repay your student loans? Are you hoping that somehow all of the ongoing damage from Deepwater Horizon isn't really there or has been really fixed? The invasions of Iraq and Afghanistan, for all the furor and the outcry that they evoked, millions of people in the street, accomplished nothing. And those invasions and those wars are irrelevant to most of us now. There's no time or motivation to protest to bring our troops home now, just as there is no time or energy to seek justice for the theft of 2000 election or the assassination of John F. Kennedy or 9/11. There are no protests in the streets calling for investigation of the housing collapse or fraudulent mortgages. Few of us can even remember, even think about Fukushima, and you wouldn't have unless I'd have brought it up. And yet, as we shall see, Fukushima is still our most important challenge. But we, all of us, we're too busy. We're all unworried. We're trying to keep our own homes. We're trying to keep our own lights on. We're trying to keep the electricity flowing, to keep our jobs, if we have them, to keep from hitting the potholes and neglected roads, to keep our children either out of jail or free from flash mobs and crime, to keep food on our tables. We're also struggling to adjust to massive and unpredictable climate change. with floods, earthquakes, droughts, heat waves, wildfires, and hurricanes, as our beleaguered Mother Earth struggles for balance in the face of petroleum man's rapacious pursuit of resources and the extinction of all life in the service of its God of infinite growth. I knew from the start that this was going to be a difficult speech to put together, and it still is. The speech is being written now even as I give it to you. I guess one of the things that I have to bring up to you now is, and this is where it's going to get touchy, and this is where we're going to bend your perceptions of reality. Because all of us here, all of you here, have sold your souls to the devil. Oh, what? He's preaching. Well, hold on a minute. Please consider for a moment these quotes from one of the greatest writers and thinkers of our time, Charles Eisenstein. They're from his awesome book, Sacred Economics, and you need to get it. That will explain to you, that will be a huge red pill for you. And you got to get it. But he talks about money, and he and I have reached a lot of the same conclusions, that we're not on an end here, but this is a miraculous transformation that's taking place. Eisenstein writes, quote, "Now this is where we're going to start to slay some gods, but we're also going to free you from traps that were built into your minds a long time ago." He writes, "In any case, one's notion of spirit is that of something separate and unworldly, that yet can miraculously intervene in the material affairs and even animate and direct them in some mysterious way. It's hugely ironic and hugely significant that the one thing on the planet most closely resembling the foremost conception of the divine is money. It is an invisible, immortal force that surrounds and steers all things, omnipotent and even limitless, an invisible hand that it is said makes the world go around. Yet money today is an abstraction, at most symbols on a piece of paper, but usually mere bits in a computer. It exists in a realm far removed from materiality, and in that realm it is exempt from nature's most important laws. For it does not decay and return to the soil as all other things do, but it is rather preserved changeless in its vaults and computer files, ever growing thanks to interest. It bears the properties of eternal preservation and everlastingness, both of which are profoundly unnatural." Looking down from the Olympian heights, Eisenstein writes, "The financiers called themselves masters of the universe, channeling the power of the god they serve to bring fortune and ruin or ruin upon the masses, to literally move mountains, raise forests, change the course of rivers, cause the rise and fall of nations. Like the clergy of a dying religion, they exhort their followers to greater sacrifice while blaming their misfortunes either on sin, greedy bankers and irresponsible consumers, or on the mysterious whims of God, the financial markets. What we call recession, earlier cultures might have called God abandoning the world. Money is disappearing, and with it, another property of spirit, the animating force of the human realm. At this writing, all over the world, machines stand idle," Eisenstein writes. "Factories have ground to a halt, construction equipment that sits derelict in the yard. Parks and libraries are closing, and millions go homeless and hungry, while the housing units stand vacant and food rots in the warehouses. Yet all the human and material inputs to build the houses, distribute the food, and run the factories still exist. It is rather something immaterial, that animating spirit which has fled. Money." He continues, "We do not realize that our concept of the divine has attracted to it a god that fits that concept, and given it sovereignty over the earth by divorcing soul from flesh, spirit from matter, and God from nature. We have installed a ruling power that is soulless, alienating, ungodly, and unnatural. So when I, Eisenstein, says, speak of money being sacred. I am not invoking a supernatural agency to infuse sacredness to the inert, mundane objects of nature. I am rather reaching back to an earlier time before the divorce of matter and spirit. Eisenstein writes, the financial crisis we are facing today arises from the fact that there is almost no social, cultural, natural, and spiritual capital left to convert into money. Centuries of near continuous money creation have left us so destitute that we have nothing left to sell. And I might add, we sold our souls a long time ago. So let me be clear today, as I stand here on this podium waiting for retribution, I am here to kill your God today. I'm here to spit in the face of a God that separated man from this planet by giving us dominion. Because it was in the separation and charging the human race and saying we had the right to rule over nature that has made everything else possible and has made us accept and swallow an infinite growth monetary paradigm that even as it's dying, we are conditioned to look to for our salvation, even while it's standing on our chest and strangling us. We did a real fine job of being masters of this planet, didn't we? Ten years ago today is a remote and historical world for most of us. Anybody remember 9/11, 2001? Does that world bear any relation to what we're living in now? It's from a mythic bygone era and of little relevance to our collective well-being or our concerns or our needs right now, this minute. No leader or commander, while in the midst of a pitched battle, would stop for a second to hold a memorial service for those fallen a decade before and take attention away from the needs of those still living and engaged in a life and death struggle, the outcome of which will decide the fate of many still living and countless more as yet unborn. We cannot afford to fiddle as Rome burns. Almost every member of the species of petroleum man has sold their soul, not to an actual deity, but to a false god. A false god with no power to enforce rules in the ether, a false god intent on killing everything on the planet. As Eisenstein said again, remember, we have created a god in the image of money. And if you look at the money in your wallet, what does it say on there? In God we trust, and the joke's been on us the whole time. Money is God. And money trusts itself to do what it does. Here's where I need to try and free you from a box. It's a trap in which your minds and hearts have been like imprisoned, and most of you for your whole lives. I call it the paradigm trap. Almost a decade ago, an assistant Muslim imam in New York City said to me, a paradigm is what you think about something before you think about it. I'm going to give you two examples of how the paradigm trap works. A few seconds ago, I mentioned an assistant Muslim imam. Your paradigm trap took you in just milliseconds through something like this. Muslim imam, oh shit, controversy. I'm not frightened of Muslims. I'm not a bigot. Did anyone react when he said Muslims? Look around furtively. Nice of Mike to be so inclusive and progressive, smile. And you went through all of that. Or something like that. You understand what I'm saying. This thinking is happening in your brain all the time. It's the box that Buckminster Fuller said we have to get free from. Get out of the box. Now, when I tell you that that same assistant Muslim imam was also an emergency room trauma physician at a Jewish hospital in Queens, and that Faz Khan was the third physician on the scene on 9/11, your paradigm thinking takes you to a completely different place. So, for as long as I've been doing this, the obstacles that I have had to overcome in people's minds, as I said, gold is going to be $500. Conspiracy theorist! As for all the things I predicted, I had to overcome the paradigm of everybody. I don't care about it anymore. But now there's a way out because you can see. So, here's another paradigm trap. I said that we had sold our souls. And that's where an even more deeply ingrained paradigm kicked in for all of you. For all of you. It was ingrained from you from birth. And it's all part of the infant growth paradigm. Before you even considered whether you had sold your soul or not, you heard me say that. You automatically accepted the fact that selling one's soul is an eternal and irrevocable fact, didn't you? That's what we were all taught. You sell your soul once, you will burn in hell, you will suffer, there's no redemption. That's what the gods of money want you to think. The gods of infinite growth, it's been drilled into you. And the truth is, to break the paradigm bubble, that anybody can have their souls back the moment they change their consciousness. You have always been the masters of your own souls. Nobody cares about punishing anybody. We just care about saving lives. We want change without punishment, change without retribution. In the real spiritual world, the real physical world, the concept or practice of punishment does not exist, and I can prove that to you. What do exist are physical laws, rules for living in balance with everything. Violate those rules and you suffer the consequences. Thou shalt not stick a paper clip into a light socket. That is sacred. Thou shalt not stick your hand in the fire. That's sacred. Thou shalt not destroy the planet which gives you life. That is sacred. If I were a bookkeeper adding up a column of numbers by hand with a pencil, assuming that you know what a pencil is, and you made a mistake, what would you do? Would you cover it up and try to hide it? Would you be overwhelmed with guilt and shame? Would you, like a Catholic flagellant, take out a whip and start beating yourselves? Or would you look for a scapegoat, somebody to blame? You might just turn the pencil over, break out the eraser, correct the mistake, fix the column of numbers, and move on. Nobody wants to punish anybody, and yet, you have all been conditioned to believe that if you abandon the god of money and if you abandon, you will have to admit that you've been wrong. You will have to admit that you've ignored people like me. You will have to admit that you've been, nobody cares about that. All I want you to do is live and survive. And that's all Mother Earth is offering you. Change your mind, quit being her enemy, and watch her become your ally. It's happening all over the world throughout the Gaian movement. I gotta recommend a great movie called Anima Mundi. If you like at all interested in Gaian and permaculture, David Holmgren's in it, I'm in it, Noam Chomsky's in it, John Seed's in it. It's an amazing movie, come out of Australia. It's kicking ass around the world. Anima Mundi, A-N-I-M-A-M-U-N-D-I, Anima Mundi. .com, animalmundimovie.com. You can find it anywhere now. It will really change the way you think. But, so after you've used the eraser now and you've corrected your column of mistakes, you realize that no animal was trying to punish you and nobody else was going to put you in jail, and there's no God waiting to punish you for that either. Change without punishment. Life-saving change. Those who taught you and me represented to you, to all of us, an artificial, contrived and now demonstrably false, corrupt, and deceitful ordering of the universe. It said that debt was the way to happiness and fulfillment. For everything. Debt's the same as sin. Somebody told you, taught you, trained you, manipulated you, and disciplined you under the implied penalties of ostracism, guilt, criticism, shame, and not living like the people you saw on television commercials. The loss of safety and support within your family, community, and a nation that was your obligation and sacred duty to incur debts which could never possibly be repaid. And they asked you to engage in employment which most likely in turn obligated others to acquire debt while assuring them that this was their path to happiness and salvation. We've all been criminal co-conspirators in it. Oh, how dare we see that? But wait a minute, nobody's waiting to punish you. We live in a culture and a civilization which demands that someone be blamed, that someone be punished. Create Osama bin Laden and then kill him. Debt and guilt have become inextricably interwoven by design in our species, thanks to the first chapter of Genesis, making it impossible for those whose greatest fear is to be cast off and alone to even consider the eraser option in their own minds. That the infinite growth economic paradigm founded upon fractional reserve banking, fiat currency, and compound interest is a fraudulent, self-defeating, self-destructive, murderous, and suicidal game should be apparent to all of us by now. The global economic paradigm is a Gordian knot. You know what a Gordian knot is? Alexander the Great was challenged by some priests. There's those priests again, those priestly fellows. You know, we have the Bernank, and you know, we have the Geithner priests, and we have the J.P. Morgan priests, and we have the all of those priests. And the priest told Alexander the Great that he could not be emperor, he could not be ruler of the world unless he could untangle the knot. And this was humdinger, I guess, you know. What did he do? He walked over with his sword. Cut it. And that's exactly the same position we are in tonight, right now, this minute, with the infinite growth monetary paradigm. The debt that is being added up everywhere in the world. I got news for you. Mother Earth cannot afford to repay $1.4 quadrillion in debt through growth, and she will not. So you have to cut it. So how do we cut it? What's emerging now as this quickening of events, and we all understand the quickening that's taking place, don't we? We see it. It was 2 years between major events. You know, then it was a year, then it was 6 months, and now they're coming boom, 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 like body blows, one after the other. And that pace is going to accelerate as the speed of collapse is going to accelerate. So the first thing, and it's just starting to emerge in the literature, at CollapseNet we scan the whole world, and we bring you that news every day. And an analysis every day. If you've been a CollapseNet member, you know that we made a lot of predictions that have probably saved you a lot of time, a lot of money, and a lot of worry. You're not being caught by surprise. But what's emerging is the first clear step that has to happen. We do not have to know what the world will look like in a perfect world, nor do we have to conceive that. This is a battle. And those of you who followed me for a while know that I've spent some time hanging out with special forces. I call them green beanies. And Navy SEALs, and we all have the same attitude. I come from families like that. I come from a warrior class, and when you are engaged in a battle and a war, you don't always know what you're gonna do next. All you know is right now, this minute, you have to deal with this issue, and you'll figure out what you gotta do next. And the first beginning step of destroying the infinite growth monetary paradigm is universal global debt forgiveness. Debt forgiveness for all debts between corporations and banks or corporations, and all debts between persons, people, bleeding, us, and corporations. All gotta go, all at once. Because it is debt that is killing us right now. And then what you have to do is you immediately have to get rid of fractional reserve banking, fiat currency, and compound interest universally. Debts between person to person can remain as long as there's no compound interest attached. So that way, if you borrowed money from your aunt, your uncle, your brother, you know, your best friend, those debts are still good. That's the beginning. That's the start. Because until we kill this beast, nothing else can be done. If you followed me for anything more than 2 minutes, you're sick of me saying one line over and over and over again. Until you change the way money works, you change nothing. Anything else is masturbation. Anything else is suicidal. Anything else is cowardly. For all the great progressives and all the protests, I've been involved in every activist protest movement from Iran-Contra to savings and loan to the POWs, the MI. We didn't change anything, did we? And all, yet all the progressives pat themselves on the back. Well, we tried. We gave it an attempt. But the big trap there, the paradigm trap, is that half measures avail us nothing. Half measures do not avail 50% results. Half measures only make things worse. Over 2,000 years ago, a prophet came and preached the forgiveness of sin. Now, I believe he was a prophet. Or was it the forgiveness of debt? And what he said was so profound that they had to kill him and shroud his life in mystery to keep the people from seeing that salvation and freedom had never been taken from them at all. I'm thinking of the words of the Lord's Prayer, which call on us to be forgiven our debts as we forgive our debtors. The Christ figure gave us a way out, but we have been taught that debt is like sin, something which only God, the God of Abraham, can forgive. That's the other big lie in your paradigm trap. Forget about it. Nobody here, nothing in the universe, especially not the plants, the creatures who live here, who are dying, who are sick, they have no interest in punishing you, but they absolutely do want you to change, and they're crying out for you to change. Has your dog, cat, parakeet, horse, goat, chicken ever tried to scold you? I know cats try to make you feel guilty sometimes, but that's different. I'm reminded of a great line by Jack London. I have never seen a wild thing feel sorry for itself. Everything alive asks is that you break out the eraser, change your ways, and move on. Now, how do you break out the eraser? How do you do that if you want to change your mind? From this moment on, if any of you have any investments in stocks, bonds, treasuries, any paper financial investments of any kind, an IRA, a 401k, you are serving the infinite growth paradigm because you have a vested interest in seeing that infinite growth continues and the corporations create profit for your benefit. And if you're 30 years old or younger, you go to your parents right now and say, you own stocks, you have a 401k, you got a real estate investment trust, you got, why are you trying to kill me? Why? You know, you might have hoped this last quarter, this collapse that I predicted so clearly, the first quarter after Fukushima, you might have had some stock in Cisco. You know how Cisco showed a profit in the wake of collapse? They fired 30,000 people. Are you willing to make a few pennies for your infinite growth investment at the cost of 30,000 jobs? Break out the eraser. Because I tell you what, you're going to lose everything anyway. The infinite growth paradigm is going to collapse. I've been predicting the market events, and just today, or just over the weekend, the German Prime Minister announced officially that Germany is expecting a Greek default. If you'd been on collapse, then you would have seen this coming for months. If Greek defaults, the EU collapses. The EU is dead. I've been on top of that for months. But I expect maybe a 500 to 900 point drop in the Dow tomorrow. It will come as soon as the markets officially acknowledge that Greece will default, which is inevitable. The EU is going to default. The German economy is shrinking, contracting. All of those bailouts are based on infinite growth. All of those bailouts are based upon everything returning to where it was in 2007 and growing from there to pay off those debts. So I charge you now with knowing that if you are invested that way, which side you're on. And here's something else. Any politician, any reporter, any pundit, any columnist, who uses the word growth in terms of economics to you from now on? You hear it? You hear Mitt Romney or the half-witted IQ Rick Perry of Texas or Michelle Bachmann or Barack Obama get up and tell you, we will get America back on the path to growth. You hear anybody say that word, they are your enemy. You know that. You don't have to argue with them. You don't have to fight with them. You just have to recognize, because this is about gathering the awareness of who your friends are, who your family is, and who they aren't, and where you put your trust. I'd like to read you something I wrote. It was published March 10, 2005, at my newsletter, From the Wilderness. Well, anybody here was an old FTW subscriber? God bless you. God bless you. This is from an essay I wrote called Global Corp, which was published at FTW March 10, 2005. Bridges are burning all around us, bridges to responses that might have mitigated the already brutal and just beginning ravages of peak oil. Bridges to reduce the likelihood of war and famine, bridges to avoid our selectively chosen suicide, bridges to change at least a part of energy infrastructure and consumption, bridges to becoming something better than we are or have been, bridges to nonviolence. Those bridges are effectively gone. 2005. Nature does not grant timeouts. The most evil statement I have heard, 2005. Detroit News columnist Thomas Bray recently described an interview with two experts, authors who come from the corporate industrial neocon camp. The aberration of his thinking is symptomatic of the guilt we all share and the consequences we all seem to be begging for. This is the quote. "We will never stop craving more," say Huber and Mills, "nor should we ever wish to. Energy is that which brings light out of dark, civilization out of disorder, prosperity out of poverty." What was the title of the book that Bray was so jazzed about? The Bottomless Well, The Twilight of Fuel, The Virtue of Waste, and Why We Will Never Run Out of Energy. These people always find ways to eke profits from a system that is in meltdown. They make money on the way up, they make money on the way down. Their appalling justification of their pact with the devil that makes all this possible is that, quote, "as long as we're making money, then everything must be okay." This is what the real powers that be believe. This is the final distilled definition of the bottom line. Not too long ago, I wrote this in 2005. Not too long ago, I had a dialogue after which an epiphany struck. As the human race blows itself into extinction or destroys the climate or starves itself to death, the last corporate merger and acquisition will take place, and at the same moment as mankind dies, the chief financial officer of Global Corp will be shouting, "Hooray, we did it!" What the lie of money has to do is to destroy its evidence. It has to kill everything so that there can be nobody alive or able to tell them that they were lying, that they were the devil, that they hoodwinked us all so that their crimes cannot be seen. They will kill everything to conceal the evidence. Many of my friends who are veterans of U.S. Army Special Forces or the SEAL teams fully understand that in battle one cannot wait to have the answers before taking action. We'll figure that out when we get to it is a real common theme, especially from the guys I knew from SEAL 6. And that's just what a warrior has to count on when you go into battle. But that's kind of what makes battle fun. That's kind of what makes it all real. When we can be absolutely pure in a straight line, from head to gut, all the way through. I'll emphasize that I'm going to pass the gold stuff. I'm sure you're going to ask about it. But here I want to digress for a moment now to those of my spiritual household. I've written a lot about my own spiritual beliefs. If you go to the CollapseNet website, there's an essay called God and Collapse, in which I flatly declare that I am Guyan and that I am an adherent of Native American spirituality. Because yeah, that's all right. We don't have to be ashamed. The real God's listening, and she's kind of, the goddess is, you know, clapping. Matter of fact, I think she just goosed me, but... what those religions, what those spiritual ways were all about were the rule books. Very simple. There was no written word. There was no Gutenberg Bible. There was no Pope. There was nobody standing in between. Every human being and every living thing on this planet had the same Bible to read, and it was the earth that we live on. And the rules for how we are for how we live in balance with that world. And their rules for survival. I say again that my only concern is for the people who will be alive after this is over. That's my mission. Because what the ones who come after know and hold will be of supreme importance to not only the future of our species, or post-petroleum human, as I have called it, but it'll be important to all life on this planet, because this planet is reaching for a higher level of consciousness now. But I have encountered a great many people along the way, still do, who look at what we do at CollapseNet, as accurate as it is, and they say, well, you know, I'm not so sure that I can handle all that negative energy. I have to take a break from it. I like to think positive. Okay. You know, but now I'm going to speak to a very limited number of people in this room, and it doesn't matter. You don't have to raise hands or nothing. Spirit wanted you to hear this. One of the most important obligations that spiritual beings now have who understand what's happening here is to bear witness. In indigenous spirituality and all the sacred traditions, the bearing of witness to watch the birth, the death, the agony, the dying, the suffering was making that experience sacred because somebody had the courage to watch it and acknowledge it. After the collapse of human industrial civilizations, we ain't going to have computers and laptops. We're going to go back to oral traditions. And they were so sacred. But if you do not assume your responsibility, and you'll know if you're called to bear witness, to record the death, the suffering, the lies, the wars, the starvation, the mistakes that have been made, if you don't do that and teach the children who come how badly we screwed things up, then we guarantee that it'll start all over again. Aside from the fact that what we do at CollapseNet is supremely useful in warning you, because how else would you have known about the radiation danger from Fukushima if CollapseNet wasn't here? And how regionally we're helping. So you need that stuff so that you can know where and when and how to move. But you have a deep spiritual obligation, those of you who are courageous enough to face it, to bear witness to all of this suffering and to teach your children well the mistakes of petroleum man. And I charge you with that tonight. Those of you all over the world who know and understand that this is spiritual warfare, to those of you who know that you will be teachers of the sacred to the young, to the unborn, you know the weight that this carries, and you will not be alone now. We are finding each other all over the planet, and we are rising in the quickening and the challenging. We are finding each other. We are finding our voice. You'll be the ones to teach the children that what sacred really means, because you want your children to live. Here's something I wrote on the CollapseNet site for our members. And as I wrote this, I was thinking about all of us in the peak oil movement, especially, who for so many decades warned, described, predicted these times. And again, I say I'm at the point now where we're celebrating how many people we did reach, not those we didn't. But the headline from the story was from a New Zealand paper, 6 months after New Zealand quake, Christchurch ability to rebuild in doubt. Whew. Quote, more than 4,000 aftershocks have hit Christchurch since one of New Zealand's worst earthquakes, hindering recovery and causing many locals to consider leaving for good. I mean, do we even remember Katrina anymore? Haiti, Hurricane Irene, Fukushima, floods, droughts. This is collapse. This is what I wrote for the members. This was envisioned and written about in detail for decades by the peak oil movement. Sing the praises of Matthew Simmons. Rich Heinberg, Robert Hirsch, Matt Savinar, Jay Henson, Richard Duncan, Colin Campbell, Jean Laharrier, Michael Caine, Carolyn Baker, Adam Porter, Jamie Hecht, and above all, Dale Allen Pfeiffer. Dale's the one who turned me loose. He introduced me to peak oil. What do we all say? We all said, big things are going to start breaking down for a whole lot of reasons, and there will not be enough energy to fix them. The Indian Ocean, tsunami, Fukushima, Katrina, Haiti, Christchurch, deep water horizon, and the ones that are coming. You know, there's a massive, all new oil drilling now is taking place in deep water because there ain't no more to find on the land. And they're going deeper and deeper. And you know what? Deep water horizons are going to get bigger and uglier and meaner. And we're about to go up and do it in the Arctic, the source of all weather. Now, what happens when you change the specific gravity, the salinity, the opacity of seawater? The North Pole is the source of all region on the planet. My father was an Air Force aviator, an interceptor, flying around over the North Pole waiting for the damn Russians. And what he was taught was that the North Pole is the source of all weather. So now we're going to go up and risk another deep water horizon up there. We're also ready to go to war. There's literal subs. It's a new generation of submarines, and there's SEAL teams, and there's warriors moving all over the region, the Canadians, the Russians, the United States, China. You get enough cats in a tight enough wet paper bag and you start shaking it, pretty soon a cat fight's going to break out. Until you change the way money works, you change nothing. We need to find a 100th monkey, and we need to find that sumbitch right now. You all know that story. If you haven't, go see the movie. Many of you will be familiar with the fact that I accurately and precisely foresaw the hows and the whys of the 2008 housing market implosion, and that the financial collapse which followed. Many of you will recall that in my biggest lecture ever at the University of Washington, Seattle, in 2005, Pacific Northwest, this is my home, this is my country. Before a crowd of 2,500, I laid it all out and I said with all the force and the conviction that I had that the first step in preparation for these days was to get out of debt. Too late for that now. Okay, it's all coming down, but that doesn't mean the game is over. Even now, everyone of these conflicts, global conflicts around the world, and we are so close to a global nuclear war, I can't tell you. Let me tell you what the people at CollapseNet know. And you know, I wrote Crossing the Rubicon, which is for sale outside. 7 years ago, I described the world we're living in today. But right now, a major global tug of war is taking place over Syria. It's like a tug of war. Because behind Syria is Iran. Behind Iran is China. They're pulling in one direction. And to the west is Europe, United States. Of course, to the north of Syria, the Kurds and the Turks. The Turks are now inches away from war with Israel. They've recalled their ambassador. They're refusing further military cooperation. Just a few days ago, the Israeli embassy in Cairo was sacked and burned. Did you know about that? Good. Good. But not only that, in Iran, or Iraq, Muqtada al-Sadr with his Mehdi army of 2 million men, who kicked the United States military's butt and fought it to a standstill in Fallujah, and the British in Basra in 2003-2004. That 2,000-man army is an army, and it's waiting because there's a deadline for all U.S. troops to leave Iraq by December 31st. On tomorrow's World News Desk for our members at CollapseNet, we have a story where Muqtada al-Sadr has just today called for a cessation of all attacks on American military personnel in Iraq to give them time to leave Iraq. But that if all American military personnel are not out of Iraq by December 31st, the war will resume with much greater intensity. And behind Muqtada al-Sadr is Iran. And behind Iran is China. But in the South China Sea, something that I described amazingly perfectly well in 2004, I said that the South China Sea was going to become one of the greatest global flashpoints because it contains not only small deposits of gas and oil, but it also contains the supply routes through which almost all the oil going to China, Japan, the Philippines, and Korea pass. If you were a CollapseNet member, you would know that those tensions are building mightily. And remember, Japan is mortally wounded, and Russian bombers are now violating Japanese airspace. Japan is calling to rewrite its constitution, allowing it to develop nuclear weapons. Is that insane? And yet, the infinite growth monetary paradigm pushes us closer by the minute to the ultimate reset button, the ultimate hiding of all evidence, a global nuclear conflict. And we are so much closer to that than almost anybody in this room can comprehend. And what's happening in the meantime? Well, we also had a little civil unrest this year. By the way, Greece is going to default in a couple of days. The Greek revolution has hit a whole new level of intensity. But we've had the riots in London. There was the first ever confrontation clash between protesters and police in Tel Aviv. We have flash mobs here, and the massive civil unrest, I'm afraid, is on the map here. It's coming in a heartbeat. Los Angeles is a tinderbox. And that blackout scared the crap out of everybody in Southern California. You trust me. And the violence will break out in the big cities like it did in the 60s, and exactly probably where it did in the 60s. Detroit, Newark, Chicago, Los Angeles. Same places we had. It's amazing how history repeats itself. Well, I've been on TV quite a bit lately. There's talk even that Howard Stern's finally going to mention my name. I should have some fun with Howard Stern. But I've been getting some press, and what I have been saying to everybody 30 and under, especially, and they've been listening. See, at CollapseNet, we got 5,500, 5,600 members, but these are movement leaders, these are opinion makers, these are the people who are doing it right now in 66 countries. And I've said very, very clearly, I don't care how mad you are, and God, you're justified to being mad for what's been done to you, for what you're being left with, how they're piling more debt on you now and trying to kill you and leave you nothing. But you must stay out of the streets. You must not get violent. I'm a warrior. I want to win this war. Because that's what they want. The United States government, Tony Blair, David Cameron, God, is he disgusting. Rush Limbaugh, everybody is doing everything in government now they can to start civil unrest. They're pushing every button. They are again trying to separate us racially. They're trying to separate us again, it's the division, it's the separation. That's the fundamental sin which must be killed, the error which must be erased. So if to anybody anywhere in the world who can hear my voice, and this is why I ask Zeitgeist to share this video, it's why I ask our Collapse Net members to make this video viral, please listen to me. The longer you can stay out of the streets and not become violent, the more stupid, evil, corrupt, foolish, and limp-dicked the old paradigm, did I say that? Excuse me, becomes. Hold it! The urge to contain, or the ability to contain the will to violence is one of the skills a warrior must master. So stay out of it, because the government's looking more stupid by the second, and pretty soon more people are going to get what the real enemy is, and I just pray that that sinks in around the world. We don't do what we do with at Collapse Net, and I haven't done what I've done over the course of a lifetime with crystal balls or magic or spells or anything like that. But I do this because we have a model that works. That model was laid out with 1,000 footnotes across the Rubicon. It's the model we use, and it's very effective. We live in an infinite growth paradigm, and infinite growth is not possible on a finite planet. Wait a minute, let me hit you with that again real quick, just so infinite growth is not possible on a finite planet. The current economic and financial paradigm is hopelessly and irrevocably corrupt. Anything they tell you is a lie. That without cheap, affordable energy, number three, economic activity must contract. That with 10 calories of fossil fuel input for every calorie of food in the industrialized world, a massive die-off and reduction of human population is inevitable. It's underway. And that the most important imperative to save lives is to, by any and all means possible, relocalize food production. This is where I have to come back to Ron Paul again. You know, he was in the video Truth and Lies of 9/11, which I made as a result of my lecture at PSU 10 years ago. That's online. I sold 25,000 of them. God knows how many hundreds of thousands of times it's been viewed. But Ron Paul wants to gut the FDA. Ron Paul wants to gut the people that will raid your farmers' markets, that will take away your raw milk, that will stop your ability to grow food and share it locally. It's amazing how his platform and the platform, you know, the beliefs of the Libertarian Party are everything the relocalization movement needs to get more deeply about its business. And for all of us here tonight, I don't know what's going to happen between now and the end of the year. This, the Committee of 12 meets for the first time in 4 days. It has to cut $1.4 trillion in the middle of the night. The Super Committee, Committee of 12, you heard of that? Unconstitutional, fast-track, unamendable legislation that they put together, send to Obama at the White House, no debate, no nothing, kind of like the Patriot Act was done. God, I wish some people would have gotten more upset about it then, but Ron Paul did. And so those cuts are going to become, and now they have to pay for Irene, which isn't never going to be paid for. And the next major disaster here, one more disaster, is enough to break everything completely. We're just waiting for another big hurricane out of the Gulf. You just had Tropical Storm Lee do some serious damage to oil and gas refining in the Gulf. And just today, Kurdistan, a part of Iraq, just suspended all oil export for no reason. Well, I mean, things are getting thick. But I have to tell you that while this winter is going to be crazy, and I have no idea about this or why, but my research says everything that I've done for 30 years to find out, to come to the conclusion that it was the separation of man from this planet, it was dominion, that whole separation, that's the fundamental evil. But now I have concluded, based upon my own research, that it's the winter of 2012 that will be the make or break winter for Homo sapiens, for mankind, for life on this planet. Now, I'm not a student of the Mayan prophecies, but I was also a detective. I don't ignore facts, you know what I'm saying? And I can only sit back with childlike wonder and watch what's happening now. And there's a part of me that's welcoming it. Because if there was that kind of clarity and that kind of spiritual vision that existed so long ago and it's proving to be true now, then it's proof if nothing else, that not everything is a lie. But we watch to see how it's going to turn out. And I just say, I am like a child as I watch all of this unfold. But between now and the end of the year, it's going to be a thrill ride. The body blows are going to come harder. They're going to come faster. They're going to be deeper. I'm looking at, again, I got to say, maybe a 500 to 900 point loss in the Dow tomorrow if the markets acknowledge the German minister's statement that Greece will default. It's going to happen sooner or later anyway. But it's going to continue to come, and the civil unrest comes. We also have to be worried about hijacking of food shipments, because we track that. Food shipments are being hijacked routinely now in interstate commerce. So anybody in a big city, any big city in the country, normally has only 3 or 4 days worth of food on hand. Your food supply lines are critical. That is another absolute critical reason why you must start growing your own food as quickly as possible. There was an experiment done, a psychology experiment done at Stanford University many years ago, where they screened a bunch of students and got all a bunch of well-balanced, very, very well-screened students, and they separated half into inmates and half into guards. And as soon as they created that division, no matter what happened, it degenerated so fast they had to stop the experiment before somebody was killed. It's the separation, it's the division which does this. I want to read you another quote from something I wrote in 2004, my second ever economic alert at From the Wilderness. It's from an essay called As the World Burns, from December of 2004. And barring a miracle, the end results will be exactly the same as from a physical attack, devastation so complete and unthinkable, magnified by the brutal impacts of peak oil, that only a few will ever try to prepare for it. That is sad, because preparation will make all the difference, barring luck or divine intervention, in who survives and to what extent they remain intact and functioning afterwards. One key to grasping the interrelatedness of these developments is to understand that dramatic economic collapse, especially in the case of a superpower or an empire, has historically created a power vacuum which has resulted in war. If, as von Clausewitz said, war is a continuation of politics by other means, then we must admit that politics is a continuation of economics. And economics is a continuation of energy. All economics, at least in this world, is founded upon energy, whether it is hydrocarbon energy or physical labor, food calories. In 2004, I offered as immediate and urgent advice: curtail all unnecessary spending, reduce credit card balances, get to know and become friends with your neighbors on all sides, keep at least a week's worth of cash and food in your home. Now I'm upping that to 3 weeks of food at least. And water, fresh water too. Look at your residence and ask yourself what you could do to improve it if there were no heat and no electricity. Start preparing for both. Look at your insulation if you own, your windows, curtains, a great source of heat loss, and roof. Buy physical gold, not paper gold. I am convinced that we will see gold reach at least $600 per ounce in 2005. It's a great way to hedge against the falling dollar. They called me a conspiracy theorist for that. So here we are at the end of this talk, and I think Spirit and I got pretty well through this. I got one last thing to say, but let me just repeat: until you change the way money works, you change nothing. And if you have a copy of this, when we get it up, we get it out, please share it. Please share it as widely as you possibly can, because we have no time left. I wrote a book called Crossing the Rubicon, The Decline of the American Empire at the End of the Age of Oil, 7 years ago, using a model that I had built from a quarter century, I described and predicted with all too alarming accuracy the world we're in today. At the very end of Crossing the Rubicon, here's what I wrote. Human beings have explored outward to the limits of this planet in search of resources, understanding, and experience. We have peered deep into boundless space, by sending probes billions of miles away and even beyond the outer planets of the solar system. We also explore backwards in times, extrapolating the sublime mysteries of the Big Bang cosmology and theoretical physics. We spend hundreds of millions of dollars and lifetimes of intellectual passion on archaeological digs to find the earliest ancestors of our bodies and our human mind. But that mind is readily seduced toward astonishing feats of domination and cruelty. The combination of bureaucracy, technology, and rationalized quantitative measurement that built the great industrial civilization of the past 200 years also created Nazi death camps. Their efficiency and centralized control were as developed as their uses were depraved and vile. The same cold administrative approach to life that built the vast economies of the modern world is also preparing a terrible solution to the collapse of those economies. In the empire's vision, love and art and religion count for nothing. It is as if the human race existed only in a statistical dimension, a calculus equation in need of a solution. Distilled, all our pursuits essentially ask just two simple questions. Who are we really, and why are we here? We have been looking in the wrong places for our answers. Let them that have ears listen. Let them that have eyes see. Thank you for having me back, Portland.